Good morning, colleagues. Today we'll start off with a breakout session into small groups. What we have done is that arising from the country studies that were done in identifying priority sectors, we then identified those priority sectors that are common to all the countries where those studies were undertaken. And these four sectors are ICT, tourism, transport and logistics, and finance. These run as a common thread across all the countries that are here. So we'd invite you to choose which sector to go to, depending on your interest and your level of participation, where you're coming from. But indeed, feel free to also take a learning curve in case you need to understand what is happening in a sector other than a sector of your interest. So we have finance in this corner, transport, logistics, and then in the far right corner there we have tourism, and on my left corner there we have ICT. We will break out for the next 1 hour, and then we'll use the next hour for discussion arising from the group discussions that we've had. So as usual, like yesterday, you have a rapporteur who's going to present what you would have discussed. Now, the focus for these group discussions is forward-looking discussion. We spent some time yesterday looking at what the constraints are. We need to now focus the discussion on what are the possible solutions to those constraints and how we can move this process and this project forward. So that's the gist of this group discussion. You are free to build on what has been done already, but we are welcoming new ideas in order to move us forward. So let's, at this stage, move into these separate groups according to sectors. Thank you. I'll invite the rapporteur for ICT to make the presentation from the discussion.
Thank you, Chair. First and foremost, I would like to ask for my apology because my voice is hoarse. I'm just developing a flu. I don't know what the problem is. Yes. So, having said that, we were looking at ICTs in terms of the challenges and also the way forward. Now, the team discussed the fact that issues of ICTs fall under three major categories. One, issues relating to availability. That is the service available or the network, is it available? So that's the first one. The second one, it also relates to the issues of access. While it's true that you may have the network being available, but are you able to access that thing? Are the people able to access those services? And the last one, they relate to the issues of affordability. So meaning that the infrastructure may be available, people may access it, but then it may be too expensive to the people that are intended to benefit from it. So basically, those are the issues that we are now going to discuss the way forward. When we go to the issues of availability, one of the constraints that we did find is that infrastructure is lacking for the most of the people, especially in the rural areas. And so what is the way forward? The way forward is that first of all, there should be an enabling registration. because we know that it's only an enabling registration that is able to foster in private investment. Secondly, you are saying that the government should be able to intervene. And how does the government do that? It does that by creating, for example, universal access funds, which is a pool of funds. And through that fund, it's able to put infrastructure, like towers, communication towers, fiber. But we are also saying that this should be done along with the private sector, because we know that the government itself should not be able to run the business. So it should be done in a coordinated approach with the private sector on a PPP principle. We are also saying that at the same time, while the government is able to put in infrastructure like towers, we know there is an energy crisis in Africa. And so the government should also, to ensure that these towers or whatever are running, there should also be deliberate effort to ensure that energy is also taken to these sites. That could be in the form of electric or solar or clean energy. So basically, those are some of the things that we discussed under the issues of availability. Now, the next point is access. What are the access challenges? Well, first and foremost, it's the legislation, which is critical, which is missing in most of the countries. You may find that the resources are not properly shared, because in one place there are maybe three communication towers. So why? Because of the poor legislation in place. So we are saying that the government should be able to put in place interconnection, access, and collocation regulations in place so as to ensure that there is fair sharing of the infrastructure. That's a starting point. We're also saying that in some government have introduced unrealistic taxes or high taxes on the equipment, which is making it impossible for the private sector to be able to fill in the gap because of the higher taxes on the equipment. So the government should be able to relook at their tax structures and realign. I think a benchmarking exercise is critical. Like in Zambia, it's one of the things that we've been doing so that our sector can become competitive. What are also other issues of access? The other issues of access relate to the skills gap that exists. These things, the networks or whatever may be available, the services may be available, but then we see that the people may not have, are not managing to access those. Why? Because of the skills gap that exists. So I was saying that there should be some intention by government to ensure that there is some training, education, issues of innovation in the ICT sector and so forth, encouraging entrepreneurships, incubation of the ideas and so forth. All these are going to enhance access to ICTs. We're also saying that I think it will also be very critical that governments implement what we call e-government programs. Now, this is a program that enables the government to take their services closer to the people. This can be done, especially those services relating to health, education, because we know these are the critical services that people need. So if the government can implement the e-governance program, then definitely it means it's going to make the services available, ICT services available to the people, and people will be able to access those. So those are some of the issues that we discussed under access. The last issue that we looked at is the issues of affordability. Now, what is this issue? Basically, we are saying that the ICT services in Africa is expensive. Of course, what are the reasons? One of the reasons is also the issues of tax. There are sometimes the huge taxes on talk time, on ICT services that are provided, which actually makes the cost of those services high. So I think that the government needs to do something or remove those taxes so that they could be affordability. But also, we realize that in some of the regulators, there is a regulatory actually failure, where the regulators are not able to live up to debt in terms of being able to analyze and come up or do what we call a cost of service study, so as to know exactly what is the cost of each item. In many countries, there is that failure, and as a result, people are exploited. So we are saying that also the training, skills training of the regulators should continue. But also there is issues of competition. Issues of competition also is there to ensure that the prices go down. I think most of you, maybe you are here, you know the simple economic theory, that wherever there is a profit, then there is a tendency for entrance. But whenever there is lack of competition, there is monopoly, then definitely it means a capitalist, there is that profit, economic profit that is lying there, and so it's abused. So basically, that's why I was saying that it's imperative that competition is allowed to flourish in the markets. Because with competition, then it would be able to drive to the level where there is the marginal cost is zero. In short, you are saying that you are going to arrive at a point where the cost is reasonable because there is no exploitation taking place. So competition, I think it's a big thing, and that's why you are saying that those countries that have not liberalized fully, that have got constraints, should be able to do away with those barriers for entry and for competition. I rest my case. Maybe my other members would like to add a few points that I have left. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. We'll open the discussion later. Let me get to the other sector, then we can have a discussion that encompasses all the sectors. Transport and logistics.
Thank you. Before I present what has been the agreement in the group, maybe it's important to explain how we approached our work. First of foremost, we brainstormed about the major challenges facing the transport and logistics services without boundaries, I mean. And we come up with so many issues ranging from political economy, challenges that the sector face, the issue of infrastructures, especially with regard to connectivity, and also there's an issue of preference to road transport than any other types of transport. This is a dominant feature in the region. And also we looked at a situation where some trucks are allowed in certain countries and others are not allowed. And also we looked at the fact that, you know, that big wave that we had on regional integration process now is like disappearing. So we discussed a lot of issues, and we had to come up with the big heading that we want to convey in terms of key message in this area of transport and logistics. And looking at this problem under the umbrella of cross-border corridors, I think there are two major areas that we need to focus on in terms of in terms of trying to improve the situation in the transport and logistics sector. One is the custom and border process. This needs to be looked at critically. We need to have more information of what is going on at cross-border corridor level. But also, I think the second point is it has to do with the need for harmonizing the regulation system and process. So these are basically the two areas that we have identified that should be a priority in terms of addressing the challenge that the sector is facing. So how that can be done in terms of way forward. I think the next wave of policy to try to improve the situation in the transport and logistics sector has to be informed policy. There should be decision, policy decision that are informed by something. And we agreed that data harmonization platform should be formed. And this is a kind of a research initiative where we can, for instance, map the challenge or the problem that are identified, for instance, in a corridor, you know, trying to identify the hotspots, where are the problems. For instance, in the Maput corridor, trying to understand from the beginning of the corridor to the end, where are the problems, so that decisions can be made, and also the users of this corridor can also make a decision as to safeguard their business. You know, so these are basically the areas that we have identified, and the way forward is that we need to have more knowledge on these particular areas, but this knowledge to be informed by something which is this data harmonization platform. Having said that, maybe I should give, if that is possible, my colleague also to contribute, if that is the case, if something has been left out. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Aminio, and we'll return to the transport and logistics discussion later. I now invite tourism to
Thank you very much, Your Excellency. Okay. First of all, I would like to thank my teammates who contributed a lot to this. I'm only representing them to rapporteur because I managed to write their contributions on the flip chart. On tourism, we realize that looking in at the challenges that have been identified across the countries on the studies, relying much on the summaries that were distributed yesterday, we realized that as a way forward, there are issues that are supposed to be addressed at a national level and those that need to be addressed at the regional level, which is SADC. And mainly with tourism, we came to understand that many of the sectors have impact on tourism. Then we're even of the thinking that if all these other groups would address their challenges, tourism would perform well. And we agreed that the policy or regulatory issues that needs to be addressed. First of all, we realized that there's existence of national policies on tourism policies, and the implementation of those policies is not that much advanced, although they contain a lot that could actually move the sector. And then at regional level, we also realize that there are certain instruments that needs to be implemented by countries. So first of all, we realize that RETOSA is working on a regional tourism strategy, which we believe that its implementation can contribute a lot to the sector realizing its potential. And that also includes marketing strategy. And we recommended that to avoid some of the challenges that are met by the tourist, SADC could consider a regional tourist visa like the EAC. We also advocate for full implementation of related SADC protocols, the main protocol on tourism, the protocols on natural resources and wildlife, water, training, that also includes recognition and qualification, harmonization. And we also advocate for national coordination mechanism because it is a fact that tourism is a priority sector in most of the SADC countries. But now the coordination between the ministries responsible for tourism and the other institutions that are entrusted for other elements that contribute to the full performance of tourism, the coordination is quite not, the mechanism, there are no mechanisms in place, and even where they are not strong enough. So that needs to be looked into, and that would include institutions responsible for immigration, security, education, transport, labor, environment, and other related. And we also realize that infrastructure is a critical element for performance of tourism in any other country. And then we recommended that there's supposed to be strong linkages within with infrastructural services, for example, telecom and transport. That would still be part of the coordination mechanism. We believe that if that mechanism it's worked out properly, then it would assist the sector to realize its potential. We also noted one of the main issues that was discussed yesterday, which is the issue of standards. We are aware that RETOSA has come up with a standardization of facilities, so we recommend that countries look into implementation of the standardization of, say, hotels, lodges, and other tourism facilities. In terms of finance, the tourism sector, it's mainly micro, small, medium enterprises. And looking into the issues that were highlighted yesterday in terms of access to finance, we found out that some countries do have their MSME policies that allows to access to finance, but it is still a challenge for business operators who are into the tourism businesses mainly for startups and even for those who would want to expand their business operations. So the issue of finance remains critical and needs to be looked into. And we also looked into the issue of skills. In those facilities that may have been to a required standard, the element of the personnel sometimes still remains the challenge. So we recommend skills and development training, mainly for the tourism industry, but also to be catered for across the value chain. Because for tourism to businesses to thrive, it needs to be supported by the other sectors across the tourism value chain. And it was also highlighted the importance of forming tourism association in the broader tourism sector, and also subsectors like hotels and accommodation seem to be one of the issues that could also help the sector to move, because in terms of advocacy and trying to build each other and also taking advantage of the available technical assistance that may be provided elsewhere. For example, Retosa assists its members in terms of skills training, but if there are no associations, it is not possible to take advantage of that. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much from the rapporteurs of the various sectoral group discussions. I want to open the floor at this stage for... Sorry. My sincere apologies. Finance. Sorry, George. You have the floor.
Looks like he hates the money.
All right. Now, thank you very much. From our group, basically, we looked at the constraints from the side of the barriers to entry, as well as access. So with the solutions which we came up were along those lines. The first issue that we came up with, we felt that since the financial sector is a highly regulated sector, we need regulations which are transparent. And then we're saying that, for instance, you find that in some countries you can't have access to directives. Just to get directives is an issue. Also, just interpreting those directives is also an issue. So we want, we say that we need transparency in regulation. Also, the formulation of such regulations sometimes is also it's unpredictable. For instance, you find that the Reserve Bank will issue regulation today, a month later they change that regulation, and then while the business is trying to adapt to the new regulations. So we were saying that predictability during policy interventions is also key. And then we're saying that the regulators themselves also need to be properly skilled and open-minded. They need to understand where the industry is going and ensure that regulations are also catching up with the times. We also mentioned that they should adopt a regulatory framework which encourages uptake of new technology. I think we've seen how the importance of technology in ensuring access to various financial services, and the regulator therefore has to ensure that he's able to adapt the regulatory system to new developments. Another issue that we looked at, we say that we feel that regional cooperation could also help in various financial services, in access to financial services. We are looking at, for instance, in the payment system, there's now a project called CIRIS, which is going to be within the SADC region and will replace SWIFT. So for money transfers, you have our own regional money transfer system similar to SWIFT within the region. With those kind of interventions, we will help with access to finance. And then we also mentioned that there's need for transparency with regards to various tariffs and charges. You note that most customers feel that the banking sector is opaque. You don't know what charges are going to apply to, for a particular transaction or particular product. Then we just need extra transparency in that area. And coupled with that, we are saying that we need more consumer protection. Issues, for instance, of capping of interest rates. You find in some countries, even if you default your loan, the loan interest will still accrue as long as that loan is still unpaid. So there isn't any caps to interest rates. As well as also the documentation itself for instance, for various loans, for opening an account, that is sometimes very complex. So we're saying that we need simple documentation, as well as, for instance, you can have bilingual account opening forms to help with access to various services. And then we also encourage that there should be we need to build skills within the financial sector itself. There we're looking at, for instance, financial literacy programs where the public just understand what banks do, what asset managers do, so that they are able to access those funds.
And then from the investment side also, we're saying that in some countries there are regulations which restrict how much, for instance, if you're a pension fund, you're not allowed, you can only invest 10% of your funds outside the country. So we're saying that we need to have less restriction, and we should allow maybe more investments within the region, especially where you find that in some countries the avenues for investment are you don't have enough avenues for investment or funds. So if you are able to have access to other regional markets, then that would also help in finance. We're also looking at, for instance, subsidizing other financial services such as microfinance and micro insurance. I think now this is just to have access to various low income earners so that they have access to these various services. The issue of also village banking came in. This is or stock fails. We're saying that should we regulate that industry? For those of you maybe who haven't heard, this is where you have groups of people lending money to each other informally. So you don't go to a bank or the money just circulates within that group. So we're saying, should we have a regulation for that or not? And also just looking at the consumer side, sometimes also the rates can be also very high, like if you annualize the rates. And then coupled to that, we're saying that maybe a good way would be to encourage what you call cooperatives, because cooperatives usually they're not as highly regulated as normal banks, and they also are not as informal as these village banking schemes. So we're saying that perhaps if we encourage these cooperatives, that could be an alternative as well. On the issue of KYC, we're saying that we need to have innovation, more innovative ways of complying with KYC. For instance, we can bring in biometrics and other issues, other technologies which will encourage people to open accounts with banks. And finally, we felt that there aren't enough development banks within the region, and that is also affecting access to venture capital. So we were of the view that if we could have more of these development banks, perhaps also you will have access to more finance. That's it. Thank you very much. Unless my team members have anything to say.
Thank you, George. Apologies again for omitting to point that you didn't speak. At this stage, I'll open the floor for those members that were in respective groups. If you want to supplement to what has already been said, or you want to comment on the other group's work, you're free to take the floor. The floor is open. Yes.
Thank you very much. I was in the transport logistics group, but I believe that we have provided a good overview. I just wanted to make a quick rejoinder to the last speaker on financial services, wherein he was referring to the probability of regulating the stock fails. Yet he has spoken to that idea under the pillar of access to finance. I believe I'm one person who has had experience with the or has insights into various stock fails and the novel advantages the stock fails have had in the various communities. If you regulate the stock fails, now you are bringing the old nemesis, who is the bank, closer to our houses. Many people are trying to run away from the banks. Now, by regulations, you are basically converting the stock fails into the banking system, and you are going to exclude people who would otherwise be included for access to finance. So I myself am a vehement supporter of stock fails. I have seen huge and well-organized stock fails. In fact, in Botswana, the Barclays Bank runs a kind of a stock fail account, properly registered and regulated, called Motelo account. And that has done tremendous things to various people in various communities. People who contribute to that account, even as little as maybe 50 pula per month. And because they are a pool of savers, at the end of their own financial years, they are able to access lots of funds, and they fund their own SMMEs. small businesses are able to pay school fees and their lives goes on. In fact, I was telling my colleagues last night that there is one so huge account to say a certain family or certain groups of people, they actually get even car loans and car houses from the same group. That's how advanced it is. So I'm not a supporter of regulations against those, as long as, for example, they are properly organized and they are run through the banks, like in the case of Barclays Bank and Botswana. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that contribution. Any other contribution or questions? Yes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I belong to the financial sector group. I think what we meant, or taking off from what the previous intervener said, he said, but FNB is running properly regulated, if I got him correct. We are not saying we should interfere with the operations of those stock files, but at the end of the day, it is still the responsibility of government to make sure that if certain things, particularly now, they now involve too many people and more funds are doing the circulation, it's still the responsibility of government to put in some regulations of some sort, not restrictive, but some regulations of some sort. We have in Lesotho, I think it's called the money lending, schemes and whatnot. I'm not quoting the law as it is, but something like that, which is light, not necessarily to bring restrictiveness, but restrictions. But the government is responsible at the end of the day. That's the point we're making. Now, coming back to the transport logistics. I'm sure the people got hot under the collars when they were discussing that, because from where I come from, there have been issues on that, very serious issues bordering on criminality in some cases, where people were fighting each other, in spite of the fact that those protocols within SADC, the conveyance of people from one border post to another and all from Lesotho to, to certain parts of South Africa here. So I was just wondering whether they didn't find it appropriate to include, is it enforcement or respect for the protocols? Because what I see there is just two things. It's not a destructive criticism, but I'm just wondering whether they didn't find it necessary to include enforcement of the protocols where they exist, because they are there, besides the two good points that they put in there. Thank you.
Thank you. That's implementing the protocols as agreed.
Thank you very much. I belong to the tourism group, and thank you, my sister, for a presentation well presented. I realize that we, in general, are talking about the issues which have always been a major problem. But I think we also need to look into the issues of climate change, the issues of natural resources management. We are here talking about sustainable development, and sometimes we tend to sort of put aside those issues which are now so critical in terms of our development as human beings and in terms of the world in general.
Thank you indeed. Like we were saying, throughout yesterday, for us, that's the business of our organization. So we can't afford to leave those aspects of, sustainability behind. I noticed a lady behind you. You have the floor?
Add on to what he said about the SADC protocols. The way that the legal structure of SADC works is that you have to domesticate the protocol basically into your own laws and regulations. So harmonization of regulation basically would be implementation of the SADC protocol. Just to add.
Thank you for that clarification. Cynthia, you asked for the floor.
Thank you for the presentations. I'd like to ask two questions, one to the ICT and another one to the tourism group. The ICT group mentioned the potential in the utilization of public-private partnerships. As I understand it, many countries in the region do not have PPP policies or regulation or legislation. I've also heard a number of governments claiming that they've been burnt in the process of being engaged in PPPs. I wonder if you know what the situation is in the countries that formed part of the group. I know I was part of the group, but we didn't go into any detail. And I wonder if you agree that there is a challenge presented by the absence of regulations or policies in that area. And then my question on the tourism is, you mentioned that the SADC region should emulate the EAC region in having a single visa. My question is the Kavango Zambezi visa not that? And if it is, are we saying that we should ask our governments to fast track its implementation? If it is not, may I ask what it is? I know it's a transfrontier conservation area, but I also understand that tourists can use a single visa across the various countries that make up that area. Thank you.
Thank you. May I request the rapporteur and any other members of the ICT group to talk to the issue of PPPs, and then I'll ask the tourism. Yes?
Thank you. I'm not an expert on triple Ps, but I think what one of the points we raised was enabling legislation. You see, that could cover all sorts of things, including triple Ps, how they you structure them, and so on. So without the enabling legislation, it would be difficult to enforce and to manage a lot of these things. I think that, so we didn't go into detail on the enabling environment in terms of what it covers, but it should cover every aspect of investments in that area. Thank you.
Thank you. You want to add?
Thank you, Chair. The issue of PPP is a trick one, but I do know that a lot is being done in terms of SADC member states to have a clear policy on the same. As my colleague has put it, I think it's part of the enabling registration. I do recall, for instance, that in Zambia, there are power stations, hydropower stations that are being developed, or that have been developed on the PP principle. For example, the Itestes power station, which was just launched, I think, last year, which is a 120 megawatts. It was done on a PP principle. So it is possible, but I think what is critical is how you structure your PP. It should be for the benefit of the private sector as well as the government. So but if it's done on a one way, being one-sided, then definitely you may find that the government or the private sector may not want to participate. So it's how you structure it. I recall, is it last week, 2 weeks ago, when we had a meeting in East Africa, in Nairobi, it was one of the issues that was presented on how to structure a balanced PPP document so that it's for the benefit of both the private sector and the government as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Tourism?
Thank you, Chair. Thank you for the question, my sister. Kavango Sambezi Visa. One question I would that just come to mind is this a SADC tourism visa, or is it a certain part of SADC? And if it is efficient, or lessons that we can learn from it apart from coding from the EAC. But in my experience, having been within the SADC region and the EAC, I just know that EAC is the one that has a regional tourism visa. That's why we had to think of learning from their experience. However, I would like my group members, and maybe Malcolm, if you know anything about this visa, to kind of help the participants. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other contributions for or additions to what has been said from the tourism group on the question of the visa? Yes, please.
I'll just add to that. So the Kavango Zambezi visa would be a start, but essentially we were talking about having a regional visa that would then replace that. So it would be for the whole of SADC. There have been a lot of challenges with that visa, and even with the Zambia-Zimbabwe one. So, SADC one would be very challenging, but would be the ideal.
Thank you. Any other contributions? Okay. Malcolm, and then at the end there, and then Nick. Malcolm?
Yep, thank you very much. Thank you. Good morning, everybody. I'm not the proud owner of a Kavango Zambezi visa. I've got in my passport here an example of the CASA visa, which was brilliant, actually. I thought it was a fantastic development. That wasn't the word I was thinking of. Because the movements across the border in that region have been really facilitated. You arrive at the Kazangula crossing, and you're faced with all kinds of different fee charges depending upon your nationality, and possibly even, dare I say it, the mood of the person who wants to issue the visa. you ask for a CASA visa, and the freedoms that gives you, which aren't really explained to you at the border, you're supposed to have done your research beforehand, but the freedom to move around the Victoria Falls sort of area has been absolutely amazing. So I would thoroughly recommend this sort of initiative. That was the word I was looking for. But I don't know anything about the other visa initiative that was talked about. The second thing I wanted to comment on just briefly about the issue about the respect for the SADC protocols, because I suppose coming from an advisor to SADC, I should say something about that. But of course, a lot of these protocols, first of all, they have to be signed and ratified by the member states that have negotiated them, and not all the member states have signed all the protocols. So in order to work out whether a particular country is in breach of its obligations under the protocols, you have to start from that point and determine whether or not they even were committed to those objectives. So, for example, the transport and communications and metrology protocol is not signed by everybody. The facilitation of the movement of people protocol, that has not been signed by very many member states, actually. This is one of the most difficult issues. So you have to start from that point. But then I think the other problem is that SADC Secretariat is not the European Commission. It doesn't have enforcement powers, so it can't... It can't force through a European Court of Justice on a member state to actually implement what they've agreed to. So that kind of that's a problem, isn't it? I mean, it's what the member states have decided to give in terms of powers to the Secretariat to act on their behalf. So in Europe, the member states have conceded that that ability to the European Commission to act in that way. The member states decided that that's what should happen. Here, the member states are so concerned about retaining all aspects of sovereignty that this enforcement power vested in another body is just not there. So that is a problem, and that's why you then find that some of the commitments that were entered into even 20 years ago. I mean, I'm thinking we discussed in the transport group very, very briefly, but the issue of market access and the so-called third country rule, which was a commitment that was made by all those member states that negotiated the transport protocol way back when it came into force in 1996, believe it or not. And that third country rule was supposed to have been phased out over 20 years and has not been phased out at all. It's still there, and nothing really has been done in all that time to address this issue of opening up the market access for the movement of goods and passengers through those sorts of commitments. So that is a real problem. So the enforcement, you know, the respect issue is not even, they're not, that is not happening. The respect of the protocols doesn't there. Once you've signed, once you've negotiated the protocol, then it's anybody's guess what will happen. Then the last thing I wanted to just say was on the whole issue of regulation, because every one of the groups has identified, as we did yesterday, the issue of regulation in one form or another, the lack of harmonisation. So when we looked in transport at the regulations that could be designed for harmonising axle weights or vehicle dimensions or driver's hours or whatever, that still needs to proceed. There's the issue of road user charges, which has not been solved yet. That's still on the books to be dealt with, and you can go round all the other sectors and see that the issue of regulation is paramount in the issues to be taken going forward. Now, as I said yesterday, we have made a start in SADC at an attempt to start addressing these regulatory issues as commitments to underpin market access and national treatment. We haven't got that far with it, and probably we won't at the sectoral level, but there are two things that are happening in going forward. First of all, under the SADC Protocol on Trade in Services, there is a provision that says that the member states agree to develop any necessary disciplines on domestic regulation. That really echoes a provision that was in the GATS from 1995. It has not been very easy to do that in the WTO. So I'm not saying that that would be easy to do, because this would be looking at cross-sectoral disciplines. So it'd be thinking about transparency right across the piece, and really what are the elements that would need to go into developing the pro-competitive regulatory environment that the ICT group has identified there. I think we need to look at what horizontal disciplines could be developed that would help to promote a better competitive environment for the region. And this is an issue which I'm really interested in, and you know, so I think that inputs from the group could be really useful, not just today, but going forward from here. And in that respect, it's also important to bear in mind that that we're not just looking at this issue from a SADC point of view, but we're having now to start thinking about what do we do with the negotiations at the continental level, which are looking at trade in services. From our point of view, we have argued that we don't think a GATS-type approach with schedules of commitments is really the best way forward for the continent of 54 countries, and that we would do better looking at the development of regulatory frameworks that would then guide the development of the sectors in the region. Maybe we start from the regulation rather than from the market access and build that in later. So this is out there as an idea floating around, and obviously we'd be interested in knowing what people think of that. Thank you very much. Sorry to be speaking so long.
No, thank you. We're grateful for your comments, Malcolm. Very useful. I have Nick, you had a pressing comment to make.
Just a point of information on the single tourist visa in the EAC. It is implemented when you arrive, if you can get it, as Malcolm was saying. I haven't figured out how to get mine yet and cheat at paying $50 at each border. But it's a wonderful story of non-tariff barriers. in services. What's happened, and Uganda is crying about this, what happened is that you as a tourist, you can cross the border if you have a single tourist visa without paying. But the tour company you're with, if they're Kenyan, or if you're Ugandan and you enter into Uganda, you will be charged as a tour operator up to $100 per passenger. So your tourists can travel freely within the EAC, but if you're on a tour bus, you are not going to cross over from Uganda into Rwanda, because Rwanda will charge you $100. So they sort of, what they've given with one, they've taken with another. So it's a perfect example, and quite, it's not so funny, but it is.
Thank you, Nick, for that information. At the back there.
Okay, thank you, Chair, for giving me the floor. I don't know if it's a question or a comment. I heard since yesterday that I'm trying to make a link with the service waiver in the WTO, and if I'm correct, the decision was taken in 2011, and it was for 15 years, and 5 years are already gone, so we're left with 10 years only. And what we're hearing is the problems and challenges and everything. So I'm starting to question the value of the service waiver WTO. Maybe the consultants can give more information on that to continue the work to identify which sector at the moment we can take advantage of the service waiver. Because if we don't have that, really, the waiver will not work, not for the LDC. And if someone can question if this was a package just to satisfy the LDC countries or something else. I know that some countries already made the offer under the service waiver, but so far I cannot name any country that can be able to take advantage of that. If you look at maybe to the tourism, depending on the mode of supply, that's where the potentiality, because tourists will come, and under the mode tour that they consume abroad, if they can't allow that, that's the all set that you can take advantage or on the service waiver. Other sectors, I'm not quite sure, especially if you look at the quality of service they have to provide to the consumer. We have a negotiation that the WTO taking place that you call TISA, that is Trade in Services Agreement, that would elevate the quality of the service that the consumer will demand. And there are some other forms that specific issues that are being negotiated in the WTO. That is meaning the quality of the service also will be increasing, and the consumer will demand more and more. Will be as the LDC in the position to offer that kind of quality of service and being competitiveness. I would like to hear comments from the presenters there and also from the plenary regarding the specific of that service waiver, if you will link it this. I remember the ambassador yesterday in your remarks, you made the link. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. What I will do at this stage is to hold your thoughts. I know what the issues that you've raised, and we're going to start with the issue of the waiver. I want us to take a bit of a break now for some 15 minutes. Let's have a coffee think through the issues that have been raised. When we do return, we'll take up the issues that you want to make from the group discussions first. Then secondly, I want us to start thinking about the sort of forward-looking issues. How do we move this forward? What do you think, how do you think you can impact your respective constituencies, where you're coming from, with the sort of discussions and take-home messages that you've had? In order to lead that sort of discussion, I will ask a few of our colleagues to lead the discussion and have in mind Julia from Nairobi. I have in mind Sue from Wilderness Safaris. I have in mind Zolompi. I have in mind Priska Chikwashi. So if you can just gather your thoughts and give us your messages on how you feel on what you have perceived from these 1.5 days of discussion and how we can take this work forward. Then we can open the floor to other participants. But let's have a 15 minutes break, and then we'll return to continue with the discussion. Thank you. We adjourned for a break upon an issue being raised from our colleague at the back of the room concerning the services waiver. I want to take opportunity, maybe when we started the meeting, I think I alluded to the issue of the waiver. Yes, indeed, the waiver was adopted in 2011 during the ministerial conference, the 8th ministerial conference in Geneva in 2011. Basically, the gist of the waiver was to render an exception to the MFN principle by allowing developed and developing countries in a position to do so. To give preferential treatment to services and service providers of LDCs to access those markets, which was, of course, pursuant to Article 16. From the time that the decision was taken in 2011 until the next ministerial in 2013 in Bali, there was no utilization of the waiver by any member. So therefore, it was felt that some decision needs to be made in order to make operation of the waiver so that it can be utilized by the members. Therefore, a decision was made to operationalize the waiver in 2013, which saw work being done by the members, especially the LDCs themselves, in trying to identify priority sectors of their own interests, and also to identify barriers, possible barriers in the preference granting countries. This work led to the LDC tabling a collective request in 2014. In 2015, a high level meeting was held in Geneva, where members, preference granting countries, presented or signaled the services and modes where they would grant preferences by way of intention. So in Nairobi, you have raised the issue of the fact that this was a 15-year, waiver, but because of the lost time between 2011 and 2015, there was need to compensate that time. So in Nairobi, a decision was made to extend the life of the waiver. You recall that it was supposed to be for 15 years. So from 2011, 15 years, it was supposed to expire in 2026, but they added 4 more years of the lost time. So now the waiver is going to expire in 2030. From my last count, I think that we have had about 23 notifications so far of preferences that members are willing to give to LDCs. Now, in order for this to be made useful by LDCs, the work needs to be done to identify, this is the work that we are doing, to look at what constraints we should address in order to make use of the waiver. So this work partly addresses the issues that you raise in order to make a full use of the waiver. So this is a work in progress, and we hope that we can contribute in this respect. If there's any addition to that issue that was raised, please make that, and then we can move to the next round of discussion. Okay. So, as I indicated, in this segment, I would want to have us look forward and see how we can make use of the discussions that we've had, the lessons that we've gotten from this 1.5 day discussions. And to lead the discussions in that respect, I have identified the following colleagues, John Stewart, who's already here, Sue, where's Sue? Sue is, please join me. Julia, please come through. And Zolompi. So the idea basically is for my colleagues here who have joined me to sort of start with you know, how they've seen the day, what the take home message is, and how they think that we can impact various constituencies moving forward, and how we can indeed move our work forward to really make a change in the services of the respective countries. So I'll start with John. Your thoughts.
Thank you very much, Darlington. If I could go, the area I'd really want to focus on is ICT, and I just want to go through some points that came out in a study I did last year, but it's very, very current and very relevant to today. I think that if you look at Africa and the extent of entrepreneurship and initiative, that there really can be massive gains can be reaped from a further rollout of ICTS. By the way, I'd like to abbreviate information and communication technology services as ICTS. That's ICT with a small s. It includes not just the physical infrastructure for communication, but obviously also platforms, which are quite interesting, because a platform is simply something that allows me to use my mobile phone to take advantage of a service that may be hosted in a different country, such as Uber or Airbnb. Obviously also includes the technology on your desktops and your laptops that we're using right now. But a whole lot of other things that are efficiency raising that we don't even notice. For example, there's a lot of trade facilitation through technology, things like single window systems, and obviously databasing, probably one of the most amazing inventions of the last 20 years that allow massive amounts of data to be easily accessed and drilled down into. When it comes to the trade aspect of ICTs, they're very pro-trade. So commercial services and various kinds of services trade have been advanced. Trade in the actual ICTs themselves, when for example, I buy something online, I'm trading in the service, but I'm also trading in there's an underlying service behind that, such as the communication backbone that I'm also utilizing. South Africa's share in ICTS is actually 25% of the developing world, which is 20% of the world. So if you've got a quick mathematical brain, you can maybe work out what that is. 25% of 20% is 5%. So it's 5% of the overall, but growth is very fast. So we're catching up. Africa's catching up. I'll talk to some of the issues behind that. When it comes to liberalization, I'm not an expert, but there are experts here. But we know that GATS is not really the vehicle that is particularly dynamic at the moment. But there's at least movement at the REC level, where RECs are starting to recognize the value, the need to look at services that they were invisible for a long time, and now they're becoming visible. So looking at Africa's readiness when it comes to infrastructure, the external connectivity is quite substantial. There are a lot of pipelines connecting Africa with the rest of the world. So Africa's ready to be connected to the rest of the world. The online or the terrestrial connectivity is much less. Fixed line rollout is difficult, it's challenging in Africa. To the focus group, I mentioned the case of the DRC. The DRC is a massive country and it's got difficult terrain to work with. So you can imagine rolling out fixed line broadband in a country like that. Obviously then wireless is the next way to go. And so we see in our urban areas that broadband in Africa is quite well rolled out, it's becoming quite well established. But we risk worsening the urban-rural divide, because we have, in the rural areas, we have poverty traps, we have information asymmetry traps, and those gaps could become worse. We have large metropoles in Africa, like Johannesburg and in Nairobi and Nigeria. What's the capital of Nigeria again? Lagos. Sorry, I don't sleep well when I'm traveling. So, okay, Abuja. Yeah. Well, but I mean Lagos. I meant Lagos as the large metropole, and where you have and the rollout there is substantial, and the rollout of cell phones is substantial. Cell phones are now smartphones, and they can do things that the previous type of feature phones couldn't do before. Africa has a program called PIDA, the Program for Infrastructural Development Africa, that's supported by the AU, which is cross-cutting across multiple countries, and it has its goal the furtherance of infrastructure projects that are cross-border. And ICT projects are part of that, but they're certainly not the major project. So what could happen is that the number of projects could be increased, specifically rolling out whether it's going to be wireless, but not letting the rural areas drop behind, and also to increase the funding level. Then the next major aspect of readiness is skills, and skills entrepreneurship and small micro enterprises. We know that small micro enterprises are dynamic. We know that they tend to create jobs. They're where a lot of innovation takes place, and they're where a lot of peer-to-peer small and micro often work with other small and micro enterprises, so they support each other. We need to get ICT to those enterprises, but not just through smartphones. It's not just communication, but it's also taking advantage of platforms. So we tend to think of communication. I can easily communicate with my clients, I can communicate with my employees, whether they're in the field. But what about utilizing a platform? What about a cooperative platform like Uber or Airbnb, where my business is hosted, maybe internationally, and I take advantage of that network? My payment system is hosted internationally, possibly. I'm going to come to that now, because e-commerce is a massive side to it. Then, thirdly, regulatory. Generally, the regulatory authorities have not caught up, or they're not catching up fast enough to the potential of ICTS, because the regulatory authorities grew out of the regulation of the communication sector, which is we tend to think of as fixed line telephone, and those have their own constraints. They're generally monopolistic because it's a massive outlay of infrastructure. So like the electricity grid. You know, you generally have got one operator, like we have here in South Africa, Telkom. It's just not practical to have multiple operators. And so therefore you need a regulator. Economic theory tells us you have to have a regulator to ensure that there's no market, you know, to mitigate against the market failures. Nick Frank spoke about some of those on day one. And so you do need regulatory bodies, but they have to catch up to how fast this sector is growing, and how IT and communications are completely integrated and each require each other to really beneficiate the maximum gains. So what can be done? Well, with regulatory authorities, one very important thing is to harmonize e-commerce laws. The problem with e-commerce, and the reason governments don't like it, is it really subverts exchange control, and it leads to disintermediation of local banks. So, for example, PayPal is an international bank now located in Singapore, which hosts probably, I don't know, 70-80% of the world's e-commerce transactions. But unless you integrate with PayPal, unless you allow entrepreneurs, micro-entrepreneurs to utilize that as a mechanism, you cannot leverage e-commerce platforms at all. That comes down to Uber, it comes down to Airbnb and the other platform-based systems. So there's got to be a realization that central banks are losing and will lose some control over the flow of funds between their citizens and the rest of the world. But that's something you have to allow in order to... So it's really cross-cutting. That's not just the regulator, but that really comes to the financial authority as well. It needs to be looked at. So you've got cross-cutting regulatory updating and regulatory modernization. Then when it comes to cost, the cost of broadband in Africa is higher than even in the rest of the developed world. So for example, in the East and in Latin America, their costs are lower. So that's got to be brought down because cost is a huge barrier to entry. You need to bring down cost, you've got to increase competitiveness. How you do that, that comes back to also the regulatory authority. Granting of licenses, we heard about this yesterday. Granting of licenses needs to be facilitated. Vetting procedures, what are the investment requirements, local versus foreign ownership requirements need to be looked at. And there needs to be foreign financing. So the initial rollouts of broadband, like we saw in South Africa with MTN and Vodacom, it's a huge spend. It's a lot of money. It's a huge investment required. But then once that technology is laid out, it just needs to be upgraded. So we upgraded then to 3G, then we upgraded to LTE. And then we broadened the number of providers. So we brought in Cell C. It's anyone's guess what the optimal number of providers is of broadband services and cell phone services. But each country has to look at what the most competitive option is. There's always a tendency, like we see with MTN in Nigeria, for a few players to emerge and to dominate, and that starts again to lead to duopoly situation, and it leads to the cost increasing. Then finally, education, training, and skills. Before you can leverage any gains from ICTS rollout, you've got to have e-literacy. So that comes down to children can take to a tablet very easy because it's touch screen, but it's got to go beyond that, and it's got to come in at the school level. We spoke last night, our group spoke about education, and we were very much in favor of online learning, where you then have to have the rollout of the technology, the rollout of the infrastructure to schools, and then schools must be able to connect, and then you can start to standardize, and you can start to start to broadcast or stream educational material, and then teachers become more tutors. So for the involvement, one needs state education, private, as well as donor education. For example, certain multinationals such as Microsoft and Apple are very involved in rolling out education into Africa, to bringing Africa on board. Google is setting up high-level drones that fly above jetliners that circulate there for months on end for Wi-Fi access. So they'll be up there. They're not satellites. They're below satellites, but they're above airliners, and they'll be there to provide wireless access to Africa, where in places especially where it's impossible, such as DRC, well, not impossible, but difficult to roll out fixed line. So a lot of the multinationals stand ready. Yes, they're interested in increasing their user base. They see Africa as a massive potential market. But those opportunities are there to be leveraged. Again, it's up to the regulators to not stand in the way. If there's a drone 70,000 feet above your country, you know, it's easy to get suspicious, maybe also superstitious as well, about what it's doing there and what it's looking at. But companies like Google, you know, need to be monitored. They become a law unto themselves. But in the end, the value add of technology is just absolutely unmistakable. And the cost of not coming on board the ICTS revolution is just huge. It's remaining in poverty traps, remaining locked out of technology is a recipe for staying in poverty traps. When it comes to government, government staff need also to update their mindsets, and they need refresher training to update their skills. I'm really talking about e-government here, which is providing of government services through the internet and through wide area networks, etc. In Cape Town, we've just moved this year to updating vehicle licenses online. So you now no longer have to stand in a queue. Believe me, some of those are some of our least favorite queues. And that's just the first step. Other potential areas are education. We've spoken about education, health services. I see there's a young African entrepreneur. He was on talk show the other day, and he's rolling out a platform system so you can access from your cell phone for accessing health advice. So if you now, let's say you wake up in the morning and your two-year-old has got a fever and they've got these symptoms and their glands are swollen, instead of having to wait 6 hours in a queue or maybe not even see a doctor that day, you go into this platform and you type in the symptoms and you can get some information. And that's the kind of innovation that we're seeing in an area where you would think, you know, well, it's not a typical area where technology would be assisting. Other areas are, I'm nearly finished. For example, so other public services administration, home affairs, applying for birth certificates, applying for visas. You should be able to do it online. And policing, and then local government, as we've already spoken about, issuing of vehicle licenses. The cost to this are going to be that some people's jobs are going to become redundant. But there's a catch-up process that needs to be, and you once just got to face these things head on, that the efficiency gains from doing this are far outweigh the adjustment costs in terms of reskilling and retooling. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Very comprehensive, thoughts on various issues affecting ICT. Sue is from the tourism sector. I'm sure you've some thoughts around that.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Darlington. And thank you very much to the ICTSD for the invitation to be here. So just a little bit of background for those who don't know me. I work for Wilderness Safaris, which is a private sector eco-tourism company operating in 8 countries in Africa. I also am the regional director of an NGO associated with Wilderness Safaris, and also the vice chair of the IUCN Tourism and Protected Areas Specialist Group. So my interest in all of this is very big because it covers a lot of what I do. I'm also a research fellow at the University of Cape Town. So it's very exciting to be involved in a platform like this from an academic point of view, a practical point of view, and hopefully an implementation point of view. So in terms of tourism, the supply and demand are already there for tourism. You've got people who want to travel to Africa, and we've got the product. So we've got the wildlife, we've got the scenery, the landscapes, and most importantly, the culture. And so I think in terms of what needs to be done is to ensure that this is managed efficiently and effectively. So by efficiently, making it easy for tourists to come to Africa, making it easy for them to travel within countries and with broader regionally and throughout the countries of Africa. Ensuring visa processes, which is why we discussed this regional visa, because certainly a lot of the tourists who come and visit our company, they will stay in one country because they had to get a visa for that country, and so they won't travel to other countries because of the difficulty. You know, especially if they arrive and they change their mind and suddenly want to go somewhere else, it's this mission to get another visa for another country, and also the cost involved. So to increase efficiency of travel. So that was why we mentioned in our presentation earlier from tourism is that we came to the conclusion in our group that, you know, the problem is actually all the other sectors. Tourism, we've got the supply and the demand. We need to get the transport right to get flights. There has been a huge improvement in terms of flights in Africa, but connecting markets and making sure that it is easy to travel. So with the new Victoria Falls International Airport, it will make access into that part of the region hugely improved, not having to come through Johannesburg. And also in terms of access mobile, so connecting to your information. Tourists, sadly, you know, do want Wi-Fi wherever they go. We have a policy that you need to disconnect to reconnect. So we don't have Wi-Fi in our camps in the Delta because we believe you come to the Delta to disconnect and reconnect with the wilderness and life. So so I love going to our camps because then I can't do email for a few days. But in terms of our business, our current tour operator business is based in Johannesburg because of the need for internet and connectivity to our markets around the world. We are a Botswana-based company, though, and we are registered on the Botswana Stock Exchange, and so we'd prefer to have our tour operating business in Botswana, but because of the lack of internet connectivity there, we can't run the business from there. All the services that have been discussed here are also interlinked to tourism. And a huge thing is the immigration, obviously. I think all of you know about the South African new immigration laws with children and that, and how that affected tourism. A number of people that I've spoken to were stopped traveling to South Africa because of those policies. And so that impact is huge. And not only, you know, from people who were negatively affected at the airport, the perception is, you know, and especially, and I think South Africa is putting themselves in a really bad position here, with the Victoria Falls Airport opening now and the new visa policies in South Africa, why come to South Africa? So from a tourism point of view, that policy needs to be looked at. We run an event for the NGO that I run. We run a fundraising event in the Greater Mahambugwe National Park that starts in Botswana. It's a cycling ride, and then crosses over an informal border into Zimbabwe and then back into South Africa over another informal border. So I've had a lot of experience working with just the three governments there and the issues that we have there. So what we have, the governments actually decided, we started a trilateral technical committee, the TTC, that meets. And on that committee, we have immigration, security, customs, tourism, and the environment. And so my suggestion to our group was, somehow we could get that at a national government level, because I think the biggest problem with tourism is that the other sectors, just no one talks to anyone else. So an example, the South African immigration laws, you know, not realizing the impact it would have on the tourism. And so to have a committee that meets with high-level ministers or staff that can discuss these issues at a national level and then ultimately at a regional level and how that impacts on that, because they are all so interconnected. And a problem that we have with this event is that we meet either in Harare or Gaborone, and those staff members at the national level are all aware of our event, but at the local level, no one knows about it. So last year we had our trucks in Zimbabwe, the drivers were arrested for bringing trucks in because they didn't know that this event was on at the local level at Bytebridge. And, you know, that shouldn't be happening. This event has been running for 8 years in the TFCA. So I'm just trying to use our example of the small little event with three countries and the issues that we have, because they are, you know, a symptom of the broader issues in the region. And I think that communication from, and I think it happens in all governments, you know, these policies are decided at a huge government level but never communicated down. And so the problems keep on rolling on. I mean, they can't even decide on the name for the Greater Mapungubwe National Park between the three governments. It still hasn't been ratified, that treaty, because they can't decide on the name. So the problems are, you know, they are not small. But I do think that the more communication there is between sectors in terms of tourism will be much better. In terms of this particular forum, I would suggest communicating with the Southern African Business Forum. I was also part of that meeting with Malcolm last month. And in terms of the tourism sector, which we were part of services, a huge amount of overlap with this project. And so I think I would advise that there is some connection, because you don't want to be doing two things at the same time. It just seems pointless, so rather connect. And on that also, I would definitely have representatives from Rotosa involved here, because so they were involved in the Southern African Business Forum, and I think in terms of regional SADC project, that, you know, it makes sense to have them, and also representatives from the tourism association, so like from BTO, from the Botswana Tourism Organization, and the Namibian Tourism Association. It would just be useful, and I mean, I'm happy to connect wherever needed, to bring people who are actually involved in the policy implementation side of things and the agreements. I think in terms of the private sector engaging with government, we try and do a huge amount of engagement with the governments. And in Botswana, we're on various forums there. And I think governments are starting to realize a lot more the need to engage private sector. And so there is a better relationship. I think it can be improved a huge amount. And I think being invited to events like this is really great to see that connection and make sure that there is a connection in that respect. I was chatting to Joe about it earlier, a paper with Anna Spensley on a specific camp that we have in the Delta called Mombo, which is on Chief's Island, and the impact that that particular camp had on policy development in Botswana and strategy of tourism and conservation. So if anyone's interested, I can share it with you. But what the paper illustrates is how if government works with private sector, how you can advance policy and develop conservation and tourism initiatives. I just also wanted to query in terms of the toolkits that are being developed through this process. How will they, I'm throwing a question back. the implementation of those toolkits, because there are so many toolkits, especially in tourism and community-based natural resource management. So I just wanted to understand, in terms of my understanding of this process going forward, what is the plan for training in terms of those toolkits and the implementation of them to make sure that it does work? We were also chatting in our group how, you know, community-based natural resource management and engaging communities started being decentralized in the 70s, 80s, and now there's a huge move to re-centralize in most countries, and we haven't seen nearly, or actually very little progress in terms of engaging communities. And a lot of that's because there's been a lot of talk and not a lot of engagement of communities. So I was on a conference call last night with our community working group in TAP, in the Tourism and Protected Area Specialist Group, and I was saying how, you know, there have been so many conferences lately with about community and benefit sharing from tourism, but the communities aren't present. And so you have all these NGOs and private sector talking about the communities, but they're not actually present to discuss the benefit sharing that they are supposed to be involved in. Just making sure that we do move forward with all these initiatives. But thank you very much.
Thank you, Sue. Julia, you are from East Africa, and obviously it's important for us to have lessons from one region to another. What are your thoughts?
Yes, sure, Darlington. Thank you so much for inviting me to this meeting. And like you said, I'm certainly not a Southern Africa expert, and I've learned so much. And I think the discussions have been really engaging, particularly in terms of sharing really practical recommendations and best practices that have worked between the different countries, and so in terms of some of the regulation issues. If it's okay, I'd like to speak to sort of the wider issues relating to trade and services. And one thing that's come up to me out of the discussions over the past day and a half is the importance of governments recognizing the export potential of services. So I think a lot of the discussions have been focused on addressing the domestic constraints within the services sector, and of course this is really important in terms of ensuring there is, you know, access and to affordable services, particularly essential services, but also services such as ICT and financial sector that can support productive growth. But I think also we need to challenge governments to look beyond that. So how can we support the growth of services sectors in terms of productivity attainment, in terms of insertion to global value chains or regional value chains that can be more forward-looking? So, for example, in terms of the ICT sector, it's so important that, you know, we ensure affordable and available services to domestic users, but what policies and regulation can be put in place and strategies in terms of national development policies that will ensure that that ICT sector can then transform into something that is, you know, exportable, such as business process outsourcing, like has been done in India. So I think there's some very important lessons, for example, from Asian countries in terms of how they have done that. The other, important focus, I think, has to be on how services growth and trade and services can support inclusivity and decent job creation. And I think I really would like to stress this decent job creation, because this is such an important element of the new SDGs agenda. It's a goal in itself, but it's also an element of the other sustainable goals. And we talked about this notion of jobless growth in manufacturing, but I think what we also risk, unless we pay attention, is poor quality jobs in the services sector. So jobs that have low value add, that are low skilled, low income, and particularly in terms of insertion to global value chains, have very low social protection for workers. So I think it's very important for governments to think about the policies and regulation that can address some of these issues when developing the services sector. And then I think just the last topic, I think all the presentations have been really fascinating, but I think for me what's also come out of them is just the lack of data and sort of lack of firm level research on services. So we actually know very little about how services firms behave in Africa in terms of their hiring practices, their linkages with other sectors, with other service firms, and the governance of service value chains. So I think really there's a need to invest a lot more in sort of sector level and enterprise level data collection on services and accompanying research. Thank you.
Thank you, Julia. And my colleague, Zolompi.
Thank you. The advantage you have of being the last to speak is that you just conclude what everybody else has said. I think there isn't much that I would add. Suffice to say that the 1.5 days that we've been in discussion, I think one thing that has come out clear is the important role of services in the integration framework for the SADC. When you're looking at SADC framework, especially in terms of the role of services, we need to look at it in the context of the treaty itself. And the treaty itself provides, for instance, in Article 21 for areas of cooperation. The reason why the areas of cooperation were chosen is that those areas which were chosen, those are enabler sectors, and one of it is trade. And in particular, we have a trade protocol in trade and services. Now, services are a key enabler sector for the open regionalism and integration of the region. In terms of what has come out from this discussion and what I picked up is that I think for every country, I think his services are key. The fact that the share of the services to GDP is on the rise, I think invariably from the presentation we had, gives us the impetus to say, I think we can do much more if we focus on the role of services. However, services are most invisible, especially at the policy and regulatory levels. That's what I think I picked up. So we need to give visibility to services in our domestic policy and framework. Now, the challenge which June has just outlined, one of the problems we encounter is a lack of reliable data in terms of how services are doing in the member states. Now, I think the information that we can carry home is probably we need to have studies that really give the visibility of the invisible impact of services on the economy. We also come across, I think, what has come out very clear is that services are cross-cutting. Services also support other sectors of the economy, for instance, industry as well as manufacturing. Now, I think some of these things, we look at them as common sense, but probably they are not common sense. We had an example from Zambia yesterday saying, look, the agricultural sector can produce a lot of produce, but if they can't transport them to the market, then they will have no impact. So there is a symbiotic relationship between services and other sectors of the economy. Key to achieving what we would want to achieve through the services are, like I said, the beauty of being the last is that you just agree with what I've said, education in terms of skills across all the sectors, be it in tourism, be it in all sectors. Without skills, we can't make headways. We may have very good policies on paper, but we need skills now to translate policies into action, actions into services, services into something deliverable. Now, skills and education is quite key to that. Infrastructure, I think we need connectivity in all the sectors. Now, the problem is we're not very well connected. Like, for instance, for Malawi, I think it is recently, I think until, I think 2 years ago, you have to fly from Malawi into ORT to fly into Mozambique. Where I can walk across the road and I'm into Mozambique,
right? So we have that kind of difficulties that probably we probably need to link on in terms of infrastructure. Energy is one of the areas I think we all, I think the lessons we get from here is that probably we need to work on the issue of energy reliance and dependency. I think the regional grid would probably be one of the areas that we can turn into. But we also need to explore other alternatives of energy, if there are, because I think, like it or not, the most of the energy we have is hydropowered, and with the climate change and our rivers are no longer giving us the same volume of water that would have required, and that is affecting generation capacity. Now, those are some of the areas that I see coming up through. The other things that I saw coming out through consensus, like I said, I'm not from a specific sector, so I will not speak specifically for a sector, but generally, is the disconnect between our regional policies and our domestic policies. The commitments we make, be it at WTO level or be it at SADC level, are not domesticated at home. Now, for as long as the regional commitments are not domesticated at home, our plan of action is actually done in isolation of the regional master plan. For instance, in the infrastructure, SADC, I think, under the Agenda 2030, there is a good regional framework infrastructure master plan. I don't know how much we've taken those into account. It's especially also in areas, for instance, in the financial services regulations. There is a SADC protocol on finance and investment, and you find that there's a lot of raw revision going on in individual member states away from the protocol. We are not syncing to the regional protocol. Now, harmonization creates or brings about legal certainty. It eliminates legal uncertainty. Legal uncertainty brings about increased transactional costs. For as long as we do not harmonize, the reason why we have regional commitments is that we should legislate with a benchmark of that. So at least we have harmonization, not unification, because I think with sovereign countries, you can have your own laws, but at least the minimum that is there has to be harmonized to facilitate movement of factors of production. On the government side, I think what has come through from the breakaway groups that I noticed is let's move away from these discussions whether we're making commitments. Delegations, country delegations are almost 99% comprised of government officials. Now, the commitments that government officials make are 99% implemented by private sector, which is not part of the decision making. I think we need to improve on that. I think as a region, because there has to be a match between those who are going to implement the commitments and those who are going to make the commitments. That's one thing that I saw that it came coming through. In terms of regulations, I think there's need to constantly revise the laws. Of course, the challenges we have is that for most of us, our economies are donor-funded, and most of the reforms are donor-supported. If the donors want a specific piece of legislation to be revised, they will fund. But we should move away from that to deliberately repositioning or say what are our priorities, areas for us to move forward in terms of development. We have beautiful master plans, economic policies, but those ones need also to be factored into our own national budget in terms of how we... Lastly, some services are probably impeded by the confusing double role of both the regulator and the service providers. I think regulators who are here, they will agree with me. The last thing they would want is to make a recommendation from their technical point of view and to be told you are wrong or this will not carry forward. Can you implement the following? What I mean is, regulators need operational independence, and there's need for minimum interference from other policymakers too, because the regulators actually know exactly what it is that they need to be doing, where they want to go, and how to get there. So operational independence is probably one of the areas that probably is impinging on the full realization of the services potential. Finally, interestingly, I think all is said and done, at the end of the day, it costs money and we need money. And one of the ways, one of the key sectors is financial services. The level of financial exclusion in the financial sectors is quite huge. But in terms of access, I think there's a consensus here that probably other alternative of banking services, for instance, money, mobile money, does ease the problem of access, although it may not give 100% financial inclusion, but does ease the issue of accessing to the funds, which would make a difference to the large majority. The demographic gift of most of Southern African economies is that a large part of the economy is rural-based and is probably not serviced by the mainstream banking services. I think if we can intensify and put in place legislation that will support that framework, I think we will be moving forward. That's what I picked up like coming through and through. Like I said, the beauty of being the last is that you don't have to repeat what others have said. It's just I agree with everything everybody has said. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your useful comments, which you know, they don't amount to agreeing. You know, you have added quite a bit of substance, and we do appreciate. We have a few minutes, say about you know, 5 minutes of participants' contributions. So if you have some contribution, please go ahead and make them. We have some 5 minutes. Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I come from the SME sector. One of the things that I think we need to put on board, to take on board, is support for the private sector, support for enterprises. So I have 2 points under that heading: entrepreneurship development. From my work, I know within the region that is a huge, huge problem. Unemployment and poverty and so on, lack of entrepreneurial skills actually adds to that. So perhaps we should also look at the development of that. And also, yesterday I did talk about capacity building of intermediary organizations. For example, if I may pick, I'll just pick a few. If I may pick an employer organization, let's say, you will find that they would like to do a lot more, but they're limited in what they can do. They might not have the capacity, they might not have, one of the key areas is, we are talking of SADC negotiations. You will find that for most countries, it's actually the government's negotiating, and they're negotiating private issues that affect the private sector, and the private sector is not invited. Even where sometimes they're invited, they don't have capacity in terms of inputs into policies. A lot of the time they will, as they operate, that's when now they start discovering that there is something wrong with this particular law. So I'm just saying, perhaps this should be infused into your actual program. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Mine is a very short comment. I would just like to commend IECS TD for your bringing together the regulators, the private sector, as well as the government. You know, with I'm coming from the private sector. And with private sector, I think we just tend to look at our own organization as it is and try to make as much revenue as I can within my organization and leave the government and the regulators to determine our fate. Yet, we are also contributing to the development of the country. And being in ICT, we are also quite a relevant aspect for area for development. We find that almost all the other priority areas that we're talking about, it's coming out that ICT is actually the main pillar for development. However, we are just leaving it to other people to determine that industry, to determine how we can contribute to our government. And I think this forum has just given us, it's just given me that determination to actually go and influence what happens, what decisions the regulator or the government makes insofar as developing our own country. Thank you.
Thank you. You ask for the floor? Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. My input is very small. I just wanted to appreciate the issue of harmonization of e-commerce laws. Indeed, we need to integrate into the global trading system. And I just wanted to know that SADC did conduct a study in 2012 on e-commerce readiness. And now the countries are now taking the SADC model law as a basis for developing their own national laws related to cyber crime or security legislation, personal data protection. So at least at this point, we managed to come up with a top-down approach, unlike where we have our separate national legislations and then it's very difficult to harmonize. So it's just to applaud that at least we are at that level and maybe we'll move somewhere. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I want to thank the panelists who had put on the spot for being a good sport and giving us your views. I appreciate, and you can take your seats. Yes, may I now invite Deborah to join me in concluding our meeting. A number of issues have been raised regarding how we move forward with this project, and you know, there's been questions raised around the development of the toolkit, how user-friendly this toolkit is going to be, and how the implementation is viewed by ICTSD. As I said, I mean, the point of the objective of this project is to see how the countries concerned can best utilize the growth that is arising from trading services and how we can enhance that growth by attending to the supply side constraints. So our focus in this project is on the supply side constraints and to see the measures and facilities that are available to rectify those constraints. I would like at this stage to invite my boss, Deborah. You know, it's the only opportunity I have to give her instructions.
Oh, that's what he says now.
Deborah, you have the floor.
Thank you, Darlington. I just want to address Darlington's last question very, very briefly before we wrap up. The issue of the toolkits. Now, this is sort of endemic into the process by which we as ICTSD work, or the process by which we attempt to create some influence in the policy, trade policy environment, such that other people are able to move forward. Now, specifically with respect to the toolkit, this is in the context of the presentation we saw yesterday from Sherry, which I actually thought was quite good. It really set out, you know, what is this context of regulation in which we as services, private sector, as policymakers operate? What is the role of regulation? Where does it help? Where does it hinder? How do you know where it helps or where it hinders? And we did see that it's one of the recurrent, in fact, probably the most pervasive theme throughout this meeting has been comments about regulations. Where is regulation necessary? And, you know, I feel terrible for the regulators, quite frankly. I would hate to be a regulator because you're loved and hated in equal measure all the time. Nothing you can do is right. So, you know, we've got to get beyond this a little bit. We all know that in almost all of the sectors we looked at, there is a dire need for good regulation. So the question is, though, it's not so simple to say what is good regulation, what is bad regulation in this context. Maybe it suits this one, but not that one. How does it suit the multiplicity of stakeholders whom it seeks to serve? Not easy. And then there's the question that came up yesterday, which surprised me a little, simply because I hadn't thought about it, is in some instances, who is the appropriate regulator? You know, is it the regulator on ICT? Is it a regulator on financial? Who should regulate in a particular instance? So realizing that these are very complex issues and they change as things evolve. We've seen tremendous evolution in certain sectors with the growth of communications, ICT, et cetera. It's changed the face of many service industries as well as other industries. So all this to say, this is a difficult, complex, and sort of big area. What we hope to do with Sherry's presentation was get the sort of basic understanding of the need for regulation, what makes it good, what makes it bad, how does it help, how does it hinder, how do you try to frame regulation. What we propose to do going forward with the assistance of a very sort of respected group in Washington is to, one of whom is right here, in fact, is South African based, is to develop a set of four regulatory toolkit, we just call them guides for want of a better word, which will look at specific sectors and say, in the sector, in general terms, what is good, what is bad, what is appropriate regulation, what is inappropriate, what is enough, what is not enough, what is too much. Understanding is how will you build political support for that regulation? How will you engage with the private sector? How will you get private sector support for that regulation? What is the appropriate sequencing? How do you, what is step A, what is step B, what is step C? Just sort of at that level. Now that will be specifically really for regulators to use. So what we would propose when we come back here at the end of this year maybe or early next year, we will have a meeting with regulators to say, do you think this will suit your needs? We are not, as ICTSD, here to impose things on anybody. You've seen the nature of our methodology is very much, we're bringing the necessary people together, we try to bring in a few things that are helpful, and we try and engender a process by which people figure out for themselves what they need. So what we would propose to do then is to meet with regulators, get the regulators in a room together to see, does this suit the need, does it not? How can it move forward and be useful? If we see after that there is further need for taking things forward, well, we'll decide that at the next meeting. So that will be back to back with a broader meeting which will include this whole group again to see where we go next. You chaps have given us some excellent input, and I want to thank you so very, very much, honestly, from the bottom of my heart, for the interest, the enthusiasm, the engagement everybody in this room has shown. It's really made a change to how we can see and understand the issues in these sectors. And I have to thank you all, too, for just being so ready and so open to leap into our methodology and work so hard, small groups, dinners, you name it, you're on the spot. Thanks to the panelists who were just put on the spot, but thanks to everybody who effectively acted as a panelist. So thank you. We think we have some ideas of the work we need to do going forward. We will try and do that work, and then we'll try and bring it back into this circle again and create a community of people who can work and think together and work to work with their constituencies to take these forward in the pursuit of sustainable development. Thank you so much again, and please, we value your feedback. I think that Sylvia has distributed feedback forms. Please give us honest feedback. If you think there's a way the format can be improved, tell us. We'll happily move forward. Please also keep in touch with us. We'll be writing to each one of you with a little bit of information over the next few weeks. Please keep in touch. Let us help to maintain this circle and work together for the future. Thank you so much for everything, and go well. Hambagartli.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I mean, apart from the thanks to the participants, you are now officially ambassadors of this project to your various constituents. You go and talk about the project and see how you can influence from what you've picked up from this meeting. May I take this opportunity to thank ASAIA, our partners, for giving us the support to hold this event. I also want to take opportunity to thank the government of Australia, who is funding this project. Again, may I reiterate thanks to all of you, and travel well to your various destinations. We thank you.